Welcome back to Let's Play Perihelion, the Prophecy. I am Amethyst Lunatari. We're in Midlight, about to enter this, I don't even know what this is, a business, a domicile. But before we do that, hold on 1 second, because... Yeah, the sound for me was a little low. Alright, so before we do that, I'm going to read some of the story from the manual. If you want to skip past it, I'm going to put timestamps for, you know, return to gameplay, I guess. So, I want to do this first, because sometimes when you click off screen, the game stops responding. Sometimes it even does that, even if you didn't click off screen. So, go figure. Perihelion the Stormy. So, interesting. A watcher from beyond the veil, the Daenor Gate marked an absolute boundary between Institute and Desert. To one side there was a district of low sprawling villas, walled and faceless. To the other was only barren waste beyond the city's perimeter. Nothing broke the emptiness of the desert but the track, a broad cobbled road that wound slowly upward toward the crest of the ridge that encircled Silhu. The heat was intolerable. By night, the desert was perceptibly cooler than by day, but scorching all the same. Though the great blazing eye of the sun was gone, the orange sands radiating the stored heat of the day toward the sky sizzled and shimmered with the intensity of a baked furnace. A strong wind was blowing. With the coming of the darkness, Finian had noticed the flow of the winds reversed, blowing now from the heart of the continent towards the sea, but it made no difference. Shore wind or sea wind, both were oppressive streams of dry, baking air that offered no mercies. Why the Psionic Training Institute was located in such a godforsaken place was beyond the reasoning of Finian. It's interesting how the psionic in the manual is a PSY, whereas in the game so far we've been seeing PSIONIC for the spelling. And yeah, Finian is the one who shows up in the manual to talk with the, I don't know, the watchman of the six genetically engineered warriors. He knew full well... was beyond the reasoning of Finian. No, that was not true. He knew full well why. He was just not willing to totally accept it. As a young bionecron apprentice psionic, the psychological acceptance that discomfort on a material plane had nothing to do with the inward control of psionic powers was one of the first and principal lessons of his training. To separate the body from the mind, to recognize the mind as the focus of all action, was the aim. To ignore physical discomfort, such as the nagging, heckling discomfort that can only be found in a place like this, was crucial if Finian was to progress. He tried to make himself love the desert. He pulled such words as bleak and dismal and repellent from his mind as though pulling fangs from a wild beast, and instructed himself to see this landscape as tender and comforting. He made himself admire the contorted strata of the exposed rock faces and the great gouges of the dry washes. He found aspects of delight in the small, toothy, nocturnal creatures that occasionally scuttered by. As the night wore on, desert did become less hateful to him, and then neutral, and at last he believed he could actually see some beauty in it. Moving away from his cell window, Finian lay down on his simple bed and, by degree, ceased to think about the desert at all. Meditation, sleep was not allowed during the time of the Manus, took over Finian's body. A meditation took over Finian's body. Sleep was not allowed during the time of the Manus. I don't know what that is. Finian's mind drifted, searching corners of his mind, searching for psionic tremors that could be utilized later for the creation of spells. He was standing on the open desert at the center of a shallow bowl of sand, a speck of pale upright life in the midst of an endless expanse of yellow. Finian had never felt so exposed, so naked to the sky. The dunes sloped up and away from him, the horizon on all sides amid a tight seal of sand and stone-gray sky. After a span that could have been moments or years in such impersonal fixed timelessness, the horizon was breached. With the ponderous surge of an oncoming storm, the dark object appeared above the rim that was the outermost limit of Finian's view. It rose and rose, impossibly tall, until its shadow fell across Finian at the hollow's depth. The shadow's impact was so sudden that it seemed almost to resound as it struck a deep, reverberating hum that shook Finian to his very bones. The great bulk of the thing came clear against the sky as it stood for a moment poised on the hollow's edge. It was a force, energy, something essentially wrong. It moved. Finian could only gape as it moved onwards, spouting sand tinged with red behind it. Finian stood frozen in its awful path as it ground on, inexorable as the millstones of hell. Now it was over him. The ground beneath Finian's feet pitched forward as the weight of the force pressed into the very earth beneath the sand. He stumbled, and, as he found his balance, the force was upon him. Finian stared, mute and horrified. A gray shadow passed before his eyes, a gray shadow with a flashing core that illuminated the black form's silhouette. A fortress, it seemed, a citadel that jarred Finian with a bolt of cold fear. The force took Finian and shook him like a hound breaking a rat's neck. Then it moved on, yanking him high in the air. Dangling, he was pulled skyward, the ground rocking and pitching beneath his head like a pulsing green sea. The wind of the force's passage was all about him as he rose, circling toward the upper reaches of the energy. The blood sang in his ears. But even as he neared the apex of the energy field, the power left his body and he felt himself falling. The ground leapt up. The two, Finian and the yellow sand, rushed together with a noise like the horns of the final day booming through the hollow. He struck. The two came together, and the wind and the light and the music of the forest blew away like a candle flame. A voice. It spoke to Finian. "I know where you are," it said. "Nowhere to run. Be still. Except I come." "No," Finian thought, he shouted, but his mouth was full of sand. "Leave me alone." "Except it is time." "No." Finian tried to struggle free, but the weight of 1,000 years of sand were upon him. "It is time." Even as this last cry echoes out through the cell, Hessian, Finian's side tutor, was crouching over him, a look of real concern over his face. "And then I woke up," explained Finian. All around the craggy, high-ceilinged stone room, in wall niches and in the very floor, pools of oil bloomed with fire. Hundreds of such lamps, each with its floating wick like a slender white worm, gave the cavern a light that far outshone the bright day outside. Despite the candle flames and the noon sun outside, the room remained cool. At the center of the light sat four figures. The psionic council sat in silence, contemplating the apprentice's words. For contemplate they did. Bionecrons, whether apprentice or adept, tapped into true psionic powers in visions such as experienced by Finian, were not to be ignored. Listor Numchika, master... that's a funny name. Master of the Institute stared into the flame of a candle caught in his vision. He was the first to break the glowing silence. Rex Helion, the 27th, must know of this. The six tubes sat side by side before an amorphous console of pressure slides and heat contact buttons. The formo glass, half-misted, failed to totally hide the black-sealed containers within, lying still and at peace. Written on the plaque attached to a metallic support sheet above the tubes were the words Project Awakening. An unnecessary announcement, Rex thought, considering the meager audience who would ever be around to appreciate it. It was a grim task. Six unborn souls had been selected for a task that might never come to pass. Six unborn as guard to protect the world from the unborn. Odd. Here was Rex Helion, Emperor of Perihelion, aiming to protect the world from an entity that might not exist for all he knew, with six people that did not exist either. Still, the task remained grim. What lay before him was the result of work by scientists, psionics, and mediators. The insurance in case of infiltration by the unborn from the planes of existence into the world, his world. All of this resulting from the calls of a prophecy via one young apprentice from the Institute of Psionics. Foolish? And impulsive? No. Rex had learned to listen to the Institute, even if he did not totally agree with everything that emanated from the place. Even if the threat of a god gone mad was never to come to fruition, it was always safer to take precautions. Look what happened to Gornikar. What happened to Gornikar? Rex shivered at the thought and turned his mind back onto the tubes. Well, he thought, I pray they six never have to awake. May their sleep be a long one. So that's that. And then here's the runes. They did these spells as like a kind of copy protection. So, I mean, you have a hard time putting them together if you don't know the combination. So here's the Periclopaedia. There's only a few entries. Perihelion. The center, the world, the culture, or just Perihelion. The current culture, which is strongly solar-centric as the name Perihelion suggests, is a leftover of an ancient, purely technocratic society which vanished in a nuclear holocaust during a time forgotten. The principal relic remaining from that era is the ruined metropolis of the ancients called simply Midlight. Where we are now. Sciences. The most advanced sciences prevalent within Perihelion are genetical in nature. It's funny, because in these entries we have a lot of, like, words put together for some reason, where space is missing. Specific subsurgical areas of activity are bionecromancy, which involves the alteration of genetical and molecular structures by the use of mental energy, computer technologies, plus a range of parasciences. Other branches of knowledge originate from the largely lost ancient culture. Examples include those nearly lost subjects of nuclear power and spaceflight. Gods. Hyperintelligent entities that can best be described as immense pools of living energy set amongst the abyss of space and time. In Perihelion, these entities are neither the center of belief or disbelief. Faith does not enter the equation, as every being in Perihelion knows, and more importantly, feels their existence. On an emotive plane, their actions range from the gentle to the sadistic. Each entity has been given a name: Ivory, Morpheum, Chrome Panther, Whisper Dance, Lavender, Neon, Toxic Waste, Vitriol, Carnivore, and the Unborn. They are a range of mediator orders. These men and women have dedicated their lives to a certain entity. The advantage or reward for this dedication is that the followers are able to utilize a portion of this entity's power as if it were their own. Note, this utilization of godly power should not be confused with the exercising of psionic power, which involves the employment of individual mental energies. One final side effect of living under the influence of specific entities is the modification of personal attributes such as strength, dexterity, or speed. Psi powers. To be able to use psi powers means being able to enter into an artificially elevated emotional state, hence triggering the deepest hidden psychical abilities of the mind. Advanced psionics, mediators, or anchorites, a renegade meteor order of Lavender, a neutral entity, can create remarkable effects, including shape-changing teleportation, creating lakes of fire, radioactive rains, or other phenomenons by voluntarily activating a handful of emotions. Races. There are a range of races of Perihelion, and most of them are artificial or the product of mutation. Human, the oldest race on Perihelion. Bionecron, spelled wrong. The race, together with the revolutionary science of bionecromancy, was created by an entity known as Neon. He manipulated a unique substance during his work, known by the Bionecrons as organic metal. With an appearance similar in many ways to mercury or chrome, organic metal is warm to the touch and smooth, resembling human skin. Bionecrons thus have a strong body form. In addition, wounds heal quickly. However, they are vulnerable to the source of their existence, the psi powers. Symbionts, a mixed artificial race. the bridge between humans and bionecrons. They have the ability to see into the future in a limited fashion, however they are not able to reproduce. Thus, due to this finite state of living, they are a doomed race. Cybern. The Cyberns are a result of an experiment to use cybernetic DNA together with human elements. They have very powerful physical abilities but lack significant mental attributes. Chimeras. This race was created by science in the time of the Bionecron Wars, when the Bionecrons, using their superior abilities against the humans, claimed to be the reigning race of the planet. There are three different types of chimeras: insectoid, reptiloid, and feline. Their creators intended to improve some of the poor or lacking human skills using these three species elements. Among the notable features utilized by the chimeras are excellent reflexes, night sight, hypnotic gaze, natural armor, active sixth sense, and controllable body temperature. Monsters. Creatures from subdimensional space that defy legal classification. The latter are stronger than those monsters that originate on the planet itself. Creatures from the latter. What latter? If you can say latter, that's implying that there's a former, but there's only one thing here. Creatures from subdimensional space that defy legal classification. Or classification. The latter are stronger. I don't know what they mean by that. Alright, so that's that. Alright, so let's see. If we go into this place, what happens? Hello? The elderly Cybern male watches you quite suspiciously as you enter into his slightly confined hall, but after recognizing the Imperial marks upon your clothing, he seems to be relieved a bit. As you look around the place, you see different chests, weaponry, and packages, which clearly shows that the owner of this place is prepared to defend his property, or leave it as quickly and safely as possible. Network. Oh. Oh, that turns that off. Okay. So you have to go into the network now to talk to this guy. Even though we're face to face, we have to talk to him with the network. Silly to save here, but, well. If we do a DIR, it costs money. See, it says zero here, but I know we have at least 5,000 credits, I think they are. Or each member has 5,000 credits. I'm not sure if it's pooled together or not. Let's save. The game's been saved. I know if we do a DIR, it costs 50. A list of files on person. Alright, so he doesn't have a network here. Let me just see something. Talk. Communication. We have ask, specified talk, item analysis, organism scan. R3 scan. Scan him. DIR command requires 10 additional credits for each file entry. I remember seeing that before. This I remember seeing. Talk. Hey guys, I'm really sorry about my distressful attitude, but in these times you can expect anything. It seems like sanity has gone from our world. And also there are those riots and lootings on the streets. Those thousands of escapees and those strange rumors about different things. I don't know exactly what's going on here, but I think it should be stopped somehow. By the way, is there anything what I can do for you? So we gotta ask him about something. Does he say the same thing again? He does. Alright, so we're supposed to ask about... I'm gonna ask him a couple things, but... I'm supposed to ask about a net code for Rexhelion? I've written down somewhere. Get encrypted netcode to the Emperor. No, still don't know what that means, if we're supposed to give it to the Emperor, or that's the netcode to get access to the Emperor. Oh no. Ask. Ask about what? Midlight. Sorry, fellows, I cannot help you this time. I have to go back into it every time. Exhalion. Netcode. Well, well, so you need the netcode to the Imperial Palace of Sunrise City. Really exciting, but I'm afraid I cannot help you with that. But not far from here lives a rather strange bionecron net expert called Yahil? Yil? Maybe he can help you. Also, there was another net station south of here, but it has been closed to prevent marauding. Oh, and it is worth to check Indigo and Global net stations. Maybe you will find something useful there. Good luck. Alright, that's good information, so... I'm looking for a place to write this stuff down. Okay. So. Not far from here. Bionecron. You. Net station south of... I mean, who even is this guy? Oh, I didn't scan him yet. My little floppy drive is blinking like crazy over there. South of bald guy. I don't know. Closed. Indigo. Global. Alright, so checking Indigo and Global net stations. See if I can get any more information here. Nope. Indigo? I'm gonna ask him one more thing. Nope, okay. Oh, scan. Nothing to scan. Organism scan. Alright, I guess we can scan him. That was expensive to upload or download anything. Exiting. I'm disappointed. I really wanted to scan this guy. How do I... Oh. So I can't look around in here, really. All I can do is hit back to leave. Alright. So I'm gonna save because I'm gonna about to drag something else off the... into the window here. Just in case the thing stops responding again. So, hope you guys don't look at this too poorly, but I'm following a map at this time. And where even is it? I found it. Alright, so I found a polar site with some maps just because I was wandering aimlessly. Last episode took a while to find anything. Took a while to find this door. So this would make the LP a little more enjoyable for you and me. Since I won't just be wandering around and you guys will be like, you were just there. You keep going to the same place. That's, I tend to do that for some reason. So this'll help me to find the stuff. So I have one map off of the CRPG Attic site. And then I have other maps off of a Polish site. You can translate the website, but you can't translate the... Well, you have to manually translate the Polish words in the legend of that map. So anyway, this is the better map. So we are here. I guess this is... Event? Can't be enemy, because this guy's not an enemy. And the M's are messages. So we've been here, this is the entrance. You got a message here, I think this is something about the vultures or something. And then this is the main street, it says main street. And then here it says you reached the northern part of town. So we've been around here. Just, I'm gonna... head... over to these areas. That's what I'm doing. Okay. Alright, so I know exactly where we are. And now we're heading west. And now north. Alright, so... There's a message up here, I don't know if you've seen. Beggars and fugitives are sleeping on the dirty sidewalk. Alright. Alright, so this is kind of a dead-end area. We have to go back to the main. Heading east for 2 and then north. So much better this way. You're in the main street of Midlight. Is that what I just pointed out? There's another message here, but I guess it only shows up once. You have reached the northern zone of Midlight. So, if we go here, it's a dead end with another message. The howl of a lonely dog echoes through the ruined walls around you. And the flavor text definitely helps. Okay, this is gonna eventually bend around. Oops. South. Nothing at all going around here. And then east. No, south. You're in the western region of the city. Indeed. We're gonna go south from here. I don't think there's a message here. It's not indicated. Nope. Alright, heading east. And there's all these little niches to the north. There was only filth and raging misery everywhere. That's pretty horrible. A young girl slips out of your sight and disappears in the shadows. Oh, is that the event? Nothing, alright. Alright, so that thought that might be somewhere to go in, but no. He's talking about Netstation to the south, right? You're right. Netstation south of him. Might be that dead end with the shadows, the vultures and stuff. Raging misery. Sounds bad. The only thing worse than misery is raging misery. Western region. And up here is something. Okay, we're going to close out this episode just like we closed out the last episode. About to head into another area on the extreme northwest corner of the map here. I'll just save the game and I'll show you exactly where I am. We are, oops, here. Here's the young girl coming out of our getting away from us. And then we are here. Bald guy we talked to is here. So, very interesting. I wonder if this is where the bio-necron called Yahil is. So we'll find out next episode. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. And always, seek adventure.